So my name is Jeremy Malcolm. I work for the Electronic Frontier Foundation in their international team, specializing on in intellectual property issues. And we have three panelists here who we thought could talk about ideas outside the box to make copyright work better in the digital environment. We have Imogen Heap, who's a Grammy Award-winning English singer-songwriter and composer. We have Marcos Alves de Souza, Director of Intellectual Rights at the Ministry of Culture of Brazil. And we have Sean Flynn, Associate Director for the Program on Information Justice and Intellectual Property at the American University Washington College of Law. The panelists, of course, may have their own views which don't necessarily coincide with EFF's views, and likewise, the reverse is also true. So we're hoping that this session will feed into WIPO's work on copyright in the digital environment. And so to begin with, I'd like us to welcome Imogen Heap to talk about her ideas on copyright in the digital environment and how music distribution can be revolutionized. I'm going to ask you all to put your earphones on because we're not going to be broadcasting the sound through the speakers in the room. So put your earphones on and then you'll be able to hear the conversation. So welcome, Imogen.
Hello. Hello. Thank you. Welcome to London.
Thank you for making the time, and I know that your schedule has been very busy and prevents you from being here in person, but we're really glad you've made the time anyway. So tell me a little bit about what your vision of a fair trade digital music ecosystem would look like.
As an artist, as a producer, as an engineer, as a writer, as all of these different hats, I've always wanted to be able to attach this information, everything to do with the song that you could possibly need to know to help it do business with the world. I wanted to find a way to attach that or link it to the song in some way. And so that anytime anybody interacted with that song, whether they were listening to it, whether they were buying it, or whether they were using it in a film, or whether they wanted to know what kind of hat I was wearing in video, then they could find this information by way of it being linked in some way. And when I was speaking to my dear friend, Zoe Keating, a very smart, wonderful, creative cellist, she told me about this thing called the blockchain. And she said, perhaps this is something that you could look into, because what the blockchain does, for mainly at that time financial institutions, is looking how do we make a transaction between two people who don't know each other, who don't maybe trust each other because they don't know each other. How can we make that trusted transaction happen without the need for a third party, without the need for a bank or mortgage lender or something like that? So this is what the blockchain has been doing for people, is to be able to make transactions with people that they don't know without the need for a trusted third party or a middleman to take a cut in between. And this is quite appealing, because in the music industry there are plenty of places that kind of collect, and many of them do great work, and it's not about cutting them out actually, but it's just the chain of efficiency and the spread of information. There's so many points in the receiving of funds and the receiving of information where it gets blocked because there is this very lack of flow of information. And so it's to do with metadata coming back to the artist so that we know where in the world our fans are, you know, what they might have listened to before. What are they interested in? How did they hear about our music? Where did they hear it? Was it on the radio? Was it in the news? You know, it was word of mouth. Did they get sent it by a friend? And how can we track this information to help us be better business people? And so the rights information, I really believe that if people had access to this information that was very easy to get to, was, you know, that there was no frustration kind of point where people, you know, had to go and look up something where, you know, who owned that song that they wanted to put on YouTube in order to get permissions for a dance piece or something that they wanted to upload. But if that information was automatically, we know that nothing is really automatic, but if this information popped up somehow by kind of scraping databases with verified information, then the fan could say, oh, this belongs to Imogen Heap, this piece of music that I like, it's called this, If I want to use it commercially, here are the terms. I tick boxes. It goes directly to digital wallets. How can we make an ecosystem for everyone wanting to interact with any property, creative property, as easy as possible and as transparent as possible with as much flow as possible? So this idea, this is what I call mycelia, is I imagine a kind of network of songs, and inside the songs, is all of this information, and whether that's linked or on a blockchain or whatever it might be, a database, linked databases, maybe not one big centralized database, but maybe just everybody agreeing to standards of commercial, ethical, and technical standards to be able to interoperate with everyone else, to how to share this information. And so imagining the songs themselves acting like beacons, going, I'm a new song on the network, come and get me. You know, I'm at this tempo, I'm good with running music, you know, having all kinds of information about it that then services could build upon. And I call the system Mycelia because the biggest organism in the world is called mycelium, and they're organisms that live beneath our feet as organic networks. And they spread information to the mushrooms and the trees, which live upon the nutrients that travel through the mycelia. And so I thought this is a great metaphor for music, which is the source of our entire industry, music industry. And without it, if we don't feed it, and if we are, you know, take a lot of, if we don't take care of the mycelia, then the mycelia will die, and so will the trees and mushrooms. And that's what's happening, is big trees are getting very, 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 very fat, but the mycelia underneath is struggling. And so how can we make this ecosystem benefit for everyone and open up new opportunities with innovation to make it possible in what they call these smart contracts on the blockchain, perhaps, where any information you could want to know, so if you're a young developer and you want to come up with the next Spotify, which, you know, is agreeable under the terms of artists and managers and producers alike, then they can search this database for songs that will be able to be populated on their service for free, maybe for the first 6 months until they get their, you know, feet going, until they get their momentum, and then, you know, set the standards for the terms in our own contract collectively, perhaps. So it's a big vision, but it's basically just about everybody getting along, sharing information that, you know, should be out there, and then most importantly, how to get that data back to the people that need to be able to do their jobs better, whether it's a marketing agency or a record label or a manager or an artist, or how can we ease up the flow, basically. I can't hear you, actually. Sorry
about that. So it's interesting that you said that this doesn't necessarily do away with the need for all music intermediaries, but to what extent does or could this initiative not necessarily eliminate but change the roles of certain gatekeepers such as labels, performance rights organisations and so on?
Well, in my view, a lot of the problems that everybody has is about, you know, who owns a song, you know, who has the splits of that song, who has the rights to that song. You know, whether you're a label, whether you're a publishing company, whether you're a PRO, you know, it's the same problem. How can we pool collectively our knowledge, our databases, and verify across all of our networks so that they become, you know, strong and robust and trusted? How can we help, you know, the collection societies to do their jobs better? You know, they're already doing amazing work, but they're each, you know, collection society or record label, they're all doing their very individual, well, actually, that's not true, because I've heard about something that's called Fast Track, which a lot of the PROs are getting together to organise this internal system so that they can, you know, perhaps, I don't know, I'm about to go and have a look at it, but I think the idea is that you, if somebody wants to use a song that has 20 writers on it across all different parts of the world, then they could collectively kind of join together and it would, you know, figure out a yes somehow from all these different people. But it's about how do we take these things and turn them into something which the artists can then use. You know, how can we link that into a flow of data that is useful for us? Not just knowing when our songs are used around the world or, you know, when they've been used in a film, but if somebody's looking for a song for a film, how can our songs be beacons in the opposite direction, instead of people going, oh, I want that song, how can our songs go, I'm free and available, or I'm £10,000 if you want to use me and I kind of sound like this, how can we make them be better beacons for us?
So
I feel like in a label perspective, like, you know, of course we still need labels, of course we still need publishing companies, we still need the amazing people who work there who are extremely creative and know the business and have brilliant ideas and marketing ideas and, you know, promotional campaigns. That's still extremely useful and very much needed, and we need them more and more as the, you know, thousands of new artists every year and millions of new songs every year. But it's just, you know, they also have problems with accounting, and sometimes when they, you know, when they pay or don't pay me, it's not often intentional that they don't pay me. It's just because the contracts are so complicated, and they don't have enough manpower to know when something was procured by a certain person under which contract terms and blah blah blah. So how can we make that side of it more automated, more for everyone to not have to try to do a job 5 to 10 times over, but actually in that, you know, where then does the exciting new possibilities come from opening that data? There's so many new marketplaces, a whole new marketplace can come up from that data. Imagine like the iPhone open up apps, you know, all these new possibilities with this data, this place, a playground to play with. But if we did that for metadata, for the songs, you could have like tourism companies wanting to travel. You could book your next holiday from your iTunes playlist because, you know, they would be able to go, oh, your favourite song was written in Outer Mongolia. Here we found a nice cafe where Imogen wrote that song, actually, if you'd like to go and visit it. And a whole new kind of areas of commerce could come out of it.
So there's a couple of questions that come out of that, and one of them is about free uses of music, which I'll come back to later. But firstly, why haven't the major labels done anything like this already, or the other music intermediaries? Why does it fall to you as an independent artist to spearhead the Mycelium initiative? So how do your priorities differ from those of the music establishment in a way?
I come at it from a single person wanting a dream. Going, wouldn't it be great if I could do this and do that, and if my songs could, you know, send me postcards every second of the day and let me know what they've been up to? A record label might have different interests in that, you know, they have a few different artists and they have a structured plan. You know, if you look at campaigns for big, big artists, you know, and you see the producers that they work with, you see the record, you know, the record companies and the people involved, and it's very much its own industry, and it works for what it works for. You know, if you look at the upper echelons of the music industry, you know, they're doing very, very nicely, thank you, and they're making a shed loads of money. But the people, you know, the kind of the middle class musician like myself, and those just starting out, we're not doing so well because we don't have the backing of that big machine in the same way. And they have to spend so much money to make enough money back for their own companies that it's inefficient for them to put, you know, maybe seed and kind of have more because the streaming, the amount of money that you make back as a startup artist is just really, really difficult to get your foot on the ladder commercially. So this is about how do we, it's also about every artist is very individual and very different and has very different talents. You know, I produce my own music, I make musical gloves, I come up with crazy ideas like Mycelia, but the next artist might be a really good cartoonist, may also be a babysitter, you know, or may like, you know, have children or whatever it might be, and they have different sets of talents. And it's about how can we find, say, you know, somebody out there wanted to find somebody to write their next music for a baby product. And then they would want to look for artists who have babies, because they'd have a more invested interest to do that, and they could give them free stuff, and da da da. So it's, you know, for a record label, that's not so interesting to them, because they're not me. I'm an individual, and I have individual needs, and they have a different need of making money out of the music that I sell, whereas I, myself, I'm suppose I'm a brand, and everything I do could, you know, has a kind of creative output for myself. So I don't know the answer to that. That was a very long-winded non-answer.
So I want to go back to something you talked about earlier, which was that some uses that this well, we can't really call it a platform, this network, this mycelia initiative, some of the uses of works that this could enable may be royalty-free or non-remunerated works. So how does that work? How does it fit in to have non-remunerated uses of music alongside the paid uses by, you know, streaming services or broadcasters or advertisers?
I don't have all the answers, but, you know, what I would love to be able to do in the world is to be able to say, do you know what, today's my birthday. And so today, all music across all services that are using music, this piece of music that people would constantly be, you know, bots would be kind of finding out all information, latest information about the songs that they hold on their services. So it's not doing out away with Spotify and all those, it's kind of helping them do their job better. So on that particular day, it might be that I demand that all my music is used for free. So anybody can download my entire collection if they want to on that day. They can, whatever they want to do. Or I may say, do you know what, today there's this you know, horrific devastation thing happening somewhere in the world, and I want to help that, I want to visibly help that. How can we create a chain of events so that when I say, you know, my music today gets, or my portion of this music gets put towards this cause for a month, and how can the song carry a little light with it, perhaps, so that when you're listening on the radio, you see a little light pop up on your radio station, and you know that means this song is going to a good cause. How can we reach out the tentacles of the artist so that they're always connected with the public? You know, because my songs, I make a song, I put it up online, it goes up instantly, it's everywhere in the world like lightning. But then this kind of circle of events never comes back to me. I don't know who listened to it, I don't know who likes it, I don't know if it's kind of blowing up in a particular place in the world, and how can I, you know, go there and help that happen, burn, kind of flame the fire, fuel the fire. But this way, to try to, yeah, keep connected with it, keep like an umbilical cord, like as the mother of the song, or all the, you know, musicians, producers, everyone, manager, in everyone who's been involved in that song should be able to still have to know what it's getting up to in the world. And so, yeah, that's the main thing, really, is just how do we receive back the data. But again, I don't know if I asked a question.
Well, no, I mean, so really the key to all of this is in the blockchain technology, correct? But it really requires a bit of development to get us to a point where we can innovate new uses, new remuneration, new platforms. Like, I wonder, for example, 15 years ago we had a global music database in the form of Napster, which was of course shut down because it wasn't remunerating artists. But do you think that Mycelium could enable the reemergence of a peer-to-peer music sharing culture that does also remunerate artists?
Well, the problem with Napster was that they did an amazing thing. You know, they had all of the music and the entire planet, pretty much, up available for people to use. What a shame that the labels couldn't, you know, move that to their advantage and, you know, take to the technology and go, wow, what can we do with this? You know, they really, really missed the trick there. They reacted too late. And then as a result, they've been kind of clawing their way back, and everybody else has been leading the way with new technologies, and they've just been kind of left behind going, help, we're going to figure this out somehow, and we're going to get back to the CDs where we made loads of money. So this is another point in time where we have this incredible new technology which can really, really change things, not just for music, but for everything around the world. It's a real game changer. And again, I don't have all the answers, and my theory isn't about, you know, going, this is the idea, we must do this. It's about going, everybody has loads of amazing ideas, not many people are talking to each other. How can we get the big labels, the small labels, the artists, the technologists, you know, the creatives, everybody involved, how can we pull together our efforts and create something that is really makes sense and solves a lot of the issues that many people are having with in regards to accounting and tracking? And how can we solve those key problems together so that we can all do our jobs better? So it's not a system at all, really, actually. It's here's an idea, and here's a, how can we make this work? Because it seems like the ideas behind it, everybody has. It's like, of course we want to remunerate artists. Of course we want to have this information. Just as an artist, I saw a chance with blockchain that it could potentially solve a few of the issues that we have. Not entirely, but it's the backbone of a change that we need to move towards if we can, which lots of people are. But really, it needs the big players and the small players to get together. And actually, it is happening. Every day, you know, people are opening up their databases. People are moving, and you know, there's endless blockchain panels. You know, literally, I mean, I get invited to one probably every week now, and just loads of music, you know, music gatherings. People really, really getting together. But how do we also? We need to find a system to be able to take the findings from one Hack Weekend or one, you know, think tank group, and mesh them together to help us move forward, so that we don't create these siloed bits of work that we do.
Well, that's a really inspiring vision, and I think connecting people is part of the reason for this session, so that a lot of the people in this room are those who really need to buy into this vision if something like this is going to move forward. So thank you very much for taking the time to present. Now, I wonder, can you hang around for questions after our next two presenters?
When would that be?
Don't worry if you can't, but if you can hang around for like the next half hour or so, or 40 minutes.
Okay, I'll head in half an hour. I've just got my little girl back there, and so I'm going to come in half an hour.
Excellent. That sounds great. Well, thank you very much, and maybe we'll see you a bit later for some questions.
Okay.
Thank you. Bye-bye. So next we're going to hear from Marcos Alves de Souza about the GRULAC proposal for the GRULAC paper, rather, on the digital environment. He's going to speak in Spanish, so if you can keep your earpieces on. And I might switch places with him so that he can advance his own slides. Would you like to sit here?
No, I
can advance the slides? Okay, let me just bring your presentation up then.
Buenas tardes a todos. Gracias, Jeremy, por esa invitación. Creo que será una buena oportunidad para hablar un poco de paper que GRULAC presentó a ese comité. Y me gustaría de hacer algunas consideraciones iniciales. La primera es que esa presentación tiene un enfoque en la música, pero se aplica también en varios aspectos a otras áreas artísticas, por ejemplo, audiovisual. Nosotros creemos que el fenómeno y los problemas son muy similares. Por favor. Please, Jeremy. Next one. Voy a iniciar hablando de los antecedentes en Brasil, porque nosotros nos interesamos por esa situación. En principio del año pasado, 2015, Google entró con una acción judicial en Brasil contra dos entidades. Una se llama UBEM, que es la Asociación de Editores Musicales, y la otra se llama ECAD, que es el Sistema de Gestión Colectiva para Ejecución Pública Musical. En esa acción, una de las cosas que Google por YouTube cuestionaba era un acuerdo operacional que había entre UBEM, los editores musicales, y la gestión colectiva, ECAD, donde los editores imponen a la gestión colectiva una distribución de los derechos de YouTube en una proporción de 75% para derechos de reproducción, o sea, para los editores, y solo 25% para ejecución. La acción en verdad versaba sobre el problema de la transferencia de datos entre YouTube y las dos entidades, pero nos llamó la atención porque hubo un movimiento de los autores y artistas de Brasil, todos los grandes autores y artistas de Brasil en el campo de música, procurar al Ministerio de Cultura para decir, mira, ¿qué está pasando con esa acción de Google? Porque nosotros ya casi no recibimos nada del digital y ahora con Google entrando en la justicia, entonces no vamos a recibir nada. Entonces nosotros hicimos una serie de reuniones con Google, con ECAD, con los editores, para saber qué estaba aconteciendo. Y una cosa que nos llamó la atención es que todavía no había ningún acuerdo sobre cuáles son los derechos que son aplicables al digital. A cada reunión que hacíamos, preguntábamos cuáles son los derechos que están siendo licenciados para YouTube y recibíamos en cada reunión una respuesta diferente. Entonces, con eso y también con la cuestión de que cada parte decía una cosa sobre cuánto está siendo pagado, nosotros iniciamos un trabajo de estudiar la situación del digital en Brasil y en el mundo. Hicimos una serie de reuniones con todos los interesados para saber al final hasta dónde podríamos llegar con nuestra legislación en Brasil y hasta dónde sería necesario una discusión internacional. Hubo cosas muy interesantes en esas reuniones. Por ejemplo, hubo una vez que nosotros proporcionamos una reunión de las plataformas con los artistas que preguntaron, por ejemplo, mira, ¿cómo ahora no hay más CD? ¿Cómo hago para tener retorno de un lanzamiento de que era hasta otro día un CD? Y el tipo de la plataforma de Deezer paró unos minutos para pensar, estaba haciendo unas cuentas y después dijo que se tendría 150 meses para tener el retorno de ingresos para poder hacer como hacían antes con un CD. Por favor, el próximo. Next one. Esa es la típica división de ingresos del digital en Brasil para música por streaming. Que nos informaron es que las plataformas quedan con 30% y 70% es la división para derechos de autor y conexos. Cuando se transforma ese 70% en un nuevo 100%, la distribución es 88% para los sellos discográficos, para las grabadoras, 9% para los editores y solo 3% para la gestión colectiva, aún así sin derechos conexos. Mira que eso está se reproduciendo en todas las plataformas y me parece que es una situación que es común, con diferencia de la pequeña parte de los 12%, cuánto va para editores para reproducción y cuánto es por comunicación al público. Next one, please. Bueno, Y autores y artistas en el entorno digital, hay un problema de fondo, porque la contratación directa para, con las plataformas es inviable. Por un lado, porque las plataformas se recusan. No hay un solo autor o artista que tiene un contrato directo con una plataforma digital. Y además hay dos tipos de trabajos que se tiene que hacer cuando está en el entorno digital que una persona sola no consigue. El primero es subir el contenido para el servidor, para la nube de la plataforma. El segundo era hacer el match, chequear dentro de las informaciones de utilización de obras cuál es su parte, y eso un artista solo, un autor solo, no consigue. Entonces tiene que recurrir a cuatro tipos, vamos a decir, de intermediarios, que no son solo intermediarios, porque algunos son también titulares de derechos. Por favor, el next one. Bueno, ECAD es un sistema muy complejo que solo existe en Brasil. Es un sistema de ventanilla única que agrega 9 asociaciones. Dentro de las 9 asociaciones hay autores, hay artistas, intérpretes, ejecutantes, editoras y grabadoras. O sea, es un sistema sui generis que existe en Brasil, pero que administra solamente derechos de comunicación al público para música. En el caso del digital, que nos llamó la atención es que no había derechos conexos en el cobro de ECAD para las plataformas. Y preguntamos por qué, y nos decían que, mira, la grabadora, el sello discográfico recibe y en tesis distribuye para los intérpretes y ejecutantes. Pero cuando preguntamos para intérpretes y ejecutantes, nos dijeron que nadie recibía. Entonces, es una situación muy extraña que nos llamó atención, porque la porcentaje de remuneración de todo que se paga a una plataforma es muy baja en términos de que llega al autor y al artista. Next one. Bueno, entonces, dentro de las opciones, ya que no es posible para una persona que sea autor o artista contratar con una plataforma, tiene que recurrir a algunos intermediarios o actores, como estoy llamando, en el entorno digital. El primero, next one, es el productor de fonograma, los sellos discográficos. Es cierto que en el digital el producto comercializado es un fonograma, pero hay una duda que nosotros tenemos, es si es una venta o si es un alquiler cuando se trata de streaming, porque hay una diferencia muy grande en términos de contratos para remunerar los terceros, si es una venta o si es un alquiler, pero nos dijeron que es una venta. Pero, mismo que el fonograma sea el producto principal, el productor de fonograma tiene responsabilidades bajo nuestra ley para con autores y artistas. Por ejemplo, hay los derechos mecánicos, que son derechos de autor, de reproducción. Y cuando el productor va a remunerar por el digital ese derecho, Há algumas alguns descuentos que se chama PPD, onde se calcula que se precisa pagar sobre o preço de faturamento del mayorista sem qualquer comprovação de qual é esse preço médio del mayorista. Además, hay los derechos artísticos de intérpretes y ejecutantes. Y en la mayoría de las veces que nos llegó es que no son pagos. Y cuando son pagos, cuando son pagados, sufren la incidencia de algunas reducciones como la tasa de rotura. O sea, es una cosa que existía quando aún existia el vinil, porque una parte del vinil se quebrava para se distribuir, y hasta hoy, por lo menos en Brasil, los contratos para el digital aún tiene tasa de rotura. La tasa de portada, o sea, para hacer la capa, cuando existía vinil y CD, y una cosa llamada MUR, Master Users Royalties, que es una división que se hace los sellos discográficos, que en los contratos la porcentaje de sello es 50% y del artista, del intérprete es 50%, pero antes de hacer eso el sello retira 68% para sí mismo y los 32% restantes se tornan el nuevo 100%, y es eso que será dividido 50-50 con el artista. Además, según la ley brasileña, los contratos antiguos no son válidos para los nuevos usos en el digital. Porque como en el streaming, por la primera vez, la música de catálogo es más importante que la nueva música, las nuevas músicas, los contratos antiguos no hacían previsión para el digital. Y eso nos lleva a una pregunta: ¿serán los usos del digital ilegales porque no están cubiertos por contratos? Por favor, next one. Bueno, otro actor son los editores musicales, que reciben un porcentaje muy menor que los sellos por el derecho de reproducción, pero en Brasil y en América Latina como un todo, hay una cosa que se llama Backoffice, que es una empresa que todos que quieren recibir derechos de reproducción tienen que pagar para esa empresa, que me parece pertenece a los editores musicales majors. Y eso nos indagó también, nos llevó a indagar si eso no se trataba de un cartel o de algún tipo de gestión colectiva ilegal, porque es una situación común incluso en los demás países de América Latina. Por favor. Y por fin, hay los agregadores o integradores de contenido, que son utilizados por los indies, o sea, por los artistas y los sellos independientes, que cobran tasas muy elevadas, no actúan en el mercado con transparencia, y también nos indagamos si no sería un tipo de gestión colectiva que sería también ilegal. Ilegal porque gestión colectiva en mi país, en varios otros, solo puede ser hecha por asociaciones sin ánimo de lucro y se tratan de empresas. Por favor, Aquí no es posible leer, pero es un contrato que es ofrecido por un agregador o integrador de contenido para los artistas que van a grabar una música o que grabaron una música que todavía no está editada. Los agregadores dicen, si la música está editada, si una editora aparece para mí cobrar, yo voy a pagar. Pero si no está editada, tiene que asignar ese contrato. El contrato dice básicamente que el artista tiene que convencer al autor a ceder sus derechos al agregador. Y después, quien tiene que pagar para el autor es el artista y no el agregador. Entonces, son contratos no mínimo extraños y que no gozan de ninguna transparencia. Por favor. Bueno, y en Brasil los productores de fonogramas, los sellos, los editores y los agregadores ahora se oponen al reconocimiento de la existencia del derecho de comunicación al público en el digital. Y más, los últimos acontecimientos llevaron a ellos a decir que streaming, en verdad, es la misma cosa que download. O sea, que es una miraje que nosotros o que el mundo entienda que hay una comunicación al público en streaming, y me parece que no es correcto pensar así. Y más, la posición de los sellos, de las grabadoras, está prevaleciendo sobre los editores y también sobre la gestión colectiva. Por favor. Entonces, todo eso nos llevó a pensar cómo podemos discutir, ya los players, las plataformas, no están propiamente en un territorio, sino en las nubes, cómo podríamos discutir eso en el seno de la OMP. Entonces, muchos autores y artistas se quejan de la baja remuneración con el digital. Surgieron nuevos actores y hay muy poca transparencia en los negocios. También hay una falta de criterios y arbitrariedad en los precios y tarifas. También no hay consenso sobre los derechos que están involucrados. Por favor. Más uno. Listo ahora algunos problemas que nosotros identificamos y no todos tratamos en el paper que Grulak presentó en el comité. El primer es Safe Harbor. Utilizo aquí una citación de Fixo, de Mikhail Fixo, sobre el problema del Safe Harbor. Regreso. Como dice Fixo, implicaciones legales y económicas deberían ser asignadas y aplicables a esos intermediarios de servicios que no restringido a una naturaleza meramente técnica, neutra y automática, y por medio de los cuales se logre obtener un ingreso significativo por la comunicación de facto de obras protegidas. Por favor, el próximo. También, el próximo. Gadi Oron, el director general de CISAC, hace algunas semanas en un seminario en Chile, hizo una presentación donde se dice la misma cosa. Más algunos. Más uno. Next one. según GAD y Orón, servicios digitales generan ingresos relevantes por el consumo de música y otros contenidos creativos, pero alegan que son solo meramente un servicio de alojamiento y alegan que no tienen el conocimiento de las actividades que ocurren en sus plataformas y pagan poco para los titulares de derechos. Más uno, el resultado es la transferencia de valor. El próximo. Hace dos días atrás hubo un side event en esta sala de IFPI, donde se dice el mismo. Incluso eso es una parte de una carta que me envió IFPI sobre ese asunto, donde se apunta que Safe Harbor sería uno de los grandes problemas del digital, porque hay usos que no están siendo pagados por empresas que se ocultan, vamos a decir, bajo las disposiciones de Safe Harbor. La próxima. RIA también, eso es de IFPI, la próxima. Next one. RIA hizo me dijo lo mismo en otra carta que me envió en Brasil sobre ese asunto. O sea, hay un problema aparentemente que pensamos que necesitaría algún tipo de discusión aquí, porque no sé si no es aquí donde nosotros podemos discutir ese tipo de asunto, no sé dónde sería. Además, el Safe Harbor está presente en todos los tratados de libre comercio que están siendo hechos, por ejemplo, el TPP, hay una disposición muy fuerte de Safe Harbor, y no sé si no sería el caso de tenermos también, no está muy indicado en nuestro paper, una discusión sobre ese asunto en el comité. Por favor, el próximo. Bueno, el otro problema es la falta de transparencia de las plataformas. Por ejemplo, ganancias con publicidad. En el caso de Google, de YouTube, pagan en Brasil por facturamiento de Google Brasil, pero parte del facturamiento con publicidad de Google en Brasil es hecho fuera de Brasil. Eso no entra en el cálculo cuando se va a pagar los autores y los artistas, y nadie sabe cuál es el valor real de las ganancias de publicidad de una plataforma como YouTube o Google. El otro problema es la participación accionaria de algunos productores de fonogramas en algunas de las plataformas digitales. Voy a tratar eso más adelante. Y la cuestión de los contratos para las músicas antiguas. ¿Están o no cubiertos para los usos en el digital? El próximo, por favor. El problema de la participación de sellos discográficos, participación accionaria en algunas plataformas digitales, lleva a una verticalización de la cadena del digital. Por un lado, se tiene, muy divulgado hace dos años, el caso de Sony Leaks, donde Sony tiene una participación accionaria en una plataforma digital con ganancias que no son repartidas con los demás titulares. Por otro lado, Google compró a Cobalt, que compró a Anra, que ahora que es una sociedad de gestión colectiva y ahora dice que va a hacer el licenciamiento del repertorio musical para el digital en el mundo. Eso crea situaciones muy extrañas y peligrosas en nuestra opinión, porque se tiene el riesgo de se construir monopolios en la cadena del digital con las plataformas o con los celos. Por favor, el próximo. Hay el problema de los acuerdos globales de licencias que son hechos por los sellos discográficos, las majors, que muchas veces esas licencias multiterritoriales no respetan a las leyes nacionales, porque, por ejemplo, no sé dónde son pagos, con certeza la licencia que es concedida para el uso en Brasil no es pago en Brasil. Y así es el mismo en toda la mayoría de los países. Y también no hay espacio para negociación. Es una situación de o estás de acuerdo o estás de fuera de ese tipo de licencia. Más una, por favor. Hay toda la cuestión de la dificultad de la aplicación de los principios basados en el ámbito físico, como el principio de territorialidad. Mira, el uso en el digital muchas veces es upload, acontece en un país, pero el streaming, la utilización está en otro. Y a pesar de ser lícito, hay una dificultad para identificar hasta dónde va la ley aplicable, porque las leyes no son iguales, incluso cuando son utilizadas para el digital. Y el otro problema es del agotamiento de derechos, porque la difusión de obras en la internet por medio de archivos digitales crea copias y materiales que dificulta la aplicación del principio de agotamiento. O sea, hasta dónde van los derechos, por ejemplo, para el streaming? ¿Hay agotamiento de derechos para el streaming y para el download? ¿Qué uno puede hacer después que se compró una copia legítima de una música? Más uno, por favor. Hay una necesidad, en nuestra opinión, de algún tipo de actualización de los marcos jurídicos sobre los usos en el entorno digital. Eso no es que estamos defendiendo una actividad normativa. En nuestra opinión, hay un vacío, que necesita ser discutido. Queremos más una discusión sobre todo y después vamos a ver si esa opinión es verdadera, es consenso entre los países. Pero el uso de obras protegidas en el entorno digital afecta a todos los países, por eso hay una necesidad de una solución a nivel mundial. Y los instrumentos jurídicos existentes no parecen apropiados para el nuevo contexto. Mira, cuando tuvimos las conferencias diplomáticas que resultaron en WCT y WPPT, no existía Google, Facebook, no existía streaming, no existían los usos que son hechos hoy, y hay algún tipo las cosas no encajan. Necesitamos discutir cómo solucionar los problemas que tenemos hoy, porque la solución de aquel momento nos parece que no está adecuada para el digital de hoy. Más uno. La otra cosa, en el caso de música, necesitamos de una base de datos mundial, porque hasta hoy todas las tentativas de hacer eso no fueron bien sucedidas y la diferencia de base de datos entre los países genera mucha incertidumbre sobre si los usos están siendo adecuadamente remunerados o no. Bueno, la otra cosa, tal vez la que más interesa a varios de los presentes, fue por eso que Jeremy me invitó, es la cuestión de la remuneración equitativa. No voy a explicar por qué, solo voy a decir una cosa. ¿De qué sirve un derecho exclusivo si yo no puedo ejercerlo? Esa es la cuestión de la remuneración equitativa. Sería interesante, con certeza, para artistas, intérpretes y ejecutantes, pero hasta para los autores tal vez sea el caso de se discutir una cosa como esa, porque el autor no consigue ejercer derechos exclusivos en el entorno digital. Entonces, ¿de qué sirve eso si no resulta en una efectiva remuneración por los usos en el digital? Más uno. Y la cuestión de las limitaciones y excepciones. El consumidor, ¿qué puede hacer con una música que hace uso en Spotify? ¿Qué puede hacer? ¿Puede hacer una copia para uso privado? ¿Qué puede hacer? ¿Cómo aplicar la regla de los tres pasos en el entorno digital? Eso no es una ofensa querer discutir limitaciones y excepciones. Es una necesidad, porque si nosotros no informamos al consumidor qué tipo de derecho tiene, qué tipo de uso puede hacer, estamos abriendo las puertas para el regreso de la piratería, porque si uno no puede hacer nada y no es informado, va a acabar haciendo cosas que no están permitidas. Entonces, nosotros pensamos que también es necesario discutir qué tipo de limitación es adecuada para el entorno digital. Y más una. Antes.
Can we have one, can you wrap up in 1 minute so that we can have?
Okay. Solo para decir más uno. Next one. Solo para decir que eso no se trata entonces de un problema contractual, sino legal. Hago uso de fixos de nuevo, que dice que es necesario algún tipo de actividad para reglamentar los contratos. Y además, me gustaría indicar que hay varios otros asuntos que nosotros pensamos que necesitarían ser discutidos en relación al entorno digital que todavía no presentamos, como, por ejemplo, contenido generado por usuarios. ¿Cuál es su régimen jurídico de protección o no es protegido? La cuestión del depósito legal de obras producidas digitalmente. La obra está producida originalmente como un archivo digital. ¿Cómo se hace depósito legal de eso? Y los derechos morales de los autores, porque las plataformas dicen que no hay espacio para indicar el autor cuando se escucha una música en un teléfono móvil. Entonces, por favor. Gracias. Eso fue muy resumido de algunas de las preocupaciones que nosotros gostaríamos de tener una discusión en el comité.
Thank you very much indeed for that, and apologies for cutting you off, but it turned out that she's finished just on time, so that's great. And our final panellist here, and I'm afraid we probably won't have time for questions, but we do want to hear very much from Sean Flynn about evaluating the benefits of fair use in the digital economy. Would you like to change places with me? Would that be easier?
That's fine. Okay. Thank you. Wow, always tough to follow Marcos, including that he'll take all of the time. That was incredibly, really interesting overview of a whole bunch of different concerns really applying within sometimes the use of copyright, but often the overall global economic system and how it doesn't distribute the resources from it evenly, which I think is a huge theme of the committee in this area. Let me speak a little bit about the role of fair use in all of this, and you know, kind of connecting between some of the themes. You know, when you're thinking about implementing the various completely new technological ways to sell and share content that we heard about in the first presentation, it often relies upon the use of those tools. Often rely upon questions about whether consumers, for instance, can download their purchase through a system like that into a cloud-based storage system, you know, that's accessible from all your different devices, whether artists themselves can use tools of reverse engineering, etc., in order to create interoperable copies to produce within those systems, etc. These questions get to the modern problem of limitations and exceptions, you know, limitations and exceptions in the modern age, which is that, and applying in the digital environment, which is that the needs for commercial enterprises and including also non-commercial enterprises, but including commercial enterprises to help artists access, sell, and distribute their works often depends upon limitations and exceptions questions within copyright law. So does your copyright law have an exception for, you know, a personal format shift into a cloud-based technology so that you could use to the full extent that consumers would really have an interest in the markets that we were talking about, you know, in the first panel. So, you know, that is really a question of how either, if you have a very, what we would say is a closed limitations and exception system, a system that has very finely ingrained and largely a reflection of the technology of the time limitations and exception systems, then you may not benefit from having access to those technologies, at least legally, until such time as your legislature changes its law. Or if you have within your limitations and exception systems more what we would call openness and flexibility and to some extent generality, within even your specific limitations and exceptions, then it may be possible to interpret many of those modern uses as permissible under your law. And that really, to me, is the question I'm most interested in looking at limitations and exceptions in the digital environment, is that question. You know, what can we figure out about whether particular laws are open to the present technologies that we already have, but that are modern and that weren't thought about in the analog world? And then even more importantly, does the limitations and exception system in your country also have the openness and flexibility necessary to accommodate the next technology? And those are the kind of factors that the academic literature is starting to look at and expose as having a very positive economic impact. That when you look at where technological production is taking place today, where it is taking place in conjunction with faster than overall GDP growth within the entertainment sector, where and the publishing sector, where all of those are growing the fastest, tend to be countries with the most openness and flexibility within their systems. And these are the different components of what make up what we talk about in fair use. And so the kind of research that we're doing is actually not focused on only looking at, okay, which legislation actually uses the words fair use in them. It's just a handful of those. They're there, but it's just a handful. But the more interesting aspect, I think, and especially for the work of this committee, is what are the actual elements that compose what we mean? Because obviously the words fair use mean nothing, especially if you're not in an English language dominant legislature. I mean, it literally has no content. But the components of what fair use has is those three elements I've talked about: openness, flexibility, and generality. In the case of fair use within an individual clause. So by openness, I mean it's openness to a range of purposes. It's not just one. And so, for instance, all fair dealing exceptions also have that component. Whether it's open to all purposes or just a collection of purposes is a distinction between some systems. And actually, that distinction does not track the words fair use. So as we heard yesterday, the Singaporean law used the terms fair dealing, but apply them to an open list of possible purposes that you can apply it to. And it was an interesting question in the discussion yesterday about whether that makes it fair use or not, right? It's whether you apply that nomenclature is just a decision of definitions, not of substance. So openness to a range of purposes. The second I would call flexibility, which is that it turns on a consideration of both the interests of the user and the greater society on the one hand, and also the interests of the right holder, including their economic interests, on the other, and it only allows the particular use where the one outweighs the other, and it forbids it in the other way. And that element of flexibility is actually present in, and this was a fantastic number that I got from Professor Seng's study, but I believe he said 142 countries have that element of fair use, and that it has both the openness of application to a wide range of purposes and turning on a flexible balancing test. And you find it most commonly in the quotation right, because those are the terms that are actually used in the Berne Convention as well. The Berne Convention quotation right in 10.1 is an open and flexible exception. It's limited to the particular purpose of quotation, but within that purpose of quotation, Berne allows, and many countries also allow, an open range of purposes. So South Africa, you know, here, it's permitted to use any quotation as long as it's compatible with fair practice. So determining whether a particular application of that law is or is not lawful, so can you excerpt web page news in order to create snippets on the internet, a live question in countries like Spain and Germany, is still open for interpretation under that law. So the need for courts to balance is not limited to fair use systems, common law systems, fair dealing systems, etc. In fact, 142 countries require courts to do that balance in some way. And that's just kind of a reaction to the idea that civil law countries can't do this. Actually, they already do. And then the openness doesn't only need to occur within fair use systems or within quotation systems. You also find them often in very specific limitations and exceptions. So Kenya's example of allowing the balancing test, whether it's necessary for the operation of the computer program, for any purpose. So you can find this kind of openness both within and between different exceptions. And the final example is generality, the idea that is there an exception in your law that is essentially a catch-all. You know, for those we left out, what do you do? Is it automatically illegal? That would be the case if you have no general exception. If you have no general exception, then the thing that was left out is illegal until the legislature changes their law. And that's really where some of the impact of open systems comes from. Now, I put the example of China here because there's different ways of doing this, and not all of them open it with a four-factor test or something like fair dealing and fair use. In China's, of course, civil law country, it opens the limitations and exceptions with application of the three-step test. It basically says for other purposes, the three-step test applies. You look at whether the disadvantage to the right holder, etc. So this is That last question of the default in a country where you have no generality is no really points to where the impacts on local innovation arise. And because essentially, you know, these kind of new technologies and services won't develop and may not even be accessible to consumers in places where there's not sufficient flexibility in the law to incorporate these things. So examples, time shifting, right? So I left copies of a response to some a PwC report in the back, which is about Australia, and we were looking at, well, when were some of these common technological problems lawful in Australia versus the US? Time shifting, so the VCR, so in the United States, 1984. In Australia, waiting for the statute to change, 2006. The VCR is technically illegal in Australia until 2006, as in many countries. I mean, many countries don't amend their law as quickly as Australia. Reverse engineering for the purpose of creating interoperable products, a key technological need. If you want to have a local video game industry, for instance, that develops video games that are interoperable with some other machine, a Nintendo, then you have to have a reverse engineering, or the development of that industry is literally illegal. So the United States, 1992, Australia, 1999. So quicker, but you still have that lag. And what does that give you? That gives a first mover advantage to the people who can get in first. Cloud services, like a remote DVR. So first DVR, Australia literally used the word video cassette until 2006. In the United States, 2008, you know, cloud-based services in Australia, not clear to this day. You know, text and data mining for the purposes of research. So, you know, making copies of articles and things like mining SSRN articles for the purposes of figuring out how many people write about Shakespeare in a given year. So lawful in the United States in 2014, lawful in very few other countries around the world. I believe the number's 32, where you could make an argument that was lawful now. And that's basically the advantage of having these elements that I've pointed to, these open, generality, flexibility, et cetera, into actually economic welfare. And so what does the research, you know, say about this? It basically tracks these areas, right? You know, the idea is that the main benefits of these components, and different studies look at different things, are enabling an environment for technical innovation, enabling research and development. You know, on the topic yesterday of education, I believe the study concluded that 18 countries have an open and flexible education exception. And in those 18 countries, what would you expect might be the result? I mean, one of the results may be easier to use digital courseware in those kind of countries. It may be easier to access educational material for various reasons. Teaching may actually be better, right? Because you can quote more easily in the classroom or use a variety of sources. So when you look at limitations and exceptions around the world, they're restricted on all these various elements. What kind of things you can copy? Is that open or closed? Does it say textbooks, or, you know, textbooks and articles and literary works, or does it also include all works, digital works, video works, audio works? You know, all these questions of openness pervade. Questions of flexibility also. What is the limitation? Does it only consider authors' rights? Does it consider the users' rights as well? Does it enable some kind of a balance to go through? And then, you know, freedom of expression and cultural flourishing. I mean, we've done a lot of work at American University in the documentary film industry, for instance. And what you find when you interview documentary filmmakers is they are able to make better films in the countries that have broad quotation rights that allow them to quote without permission, especially when you're living in South Africa. It's really hard to get Hollywood to respond to your letter. And that allow them to use those products in a more free way. And it's better for the consumer to watch those films because they're more interesting. You know, so you actually quoting CNN's news coverage when you're commenting on it, or are you quoting somebody, are you describing it with a narrator? It makes the quality of cultural production better. And this is always actually the issue I have with the publishing industry on this one, and I'll pick that one for a moment. But that publishing is better in systems with better, more open, flexible quotation rights, for instance. So I think actually all parties in the room advantage from elements of openness and flexibility, whether or not it's put all together within a single fair use clause or not, whether or not it uses the US magic words fair use, you know, whether or not it tries to take advantage of any of those things. And so we are undertaking a research project to try to collect information, categorize limitations and exceptions along those lines in order to try to look at econometric research and industry studies and things like that to actually figure out if some of those hypotheses are true. You know, does the technology industry do better in countries with more open limitations and exceptions? Does the publishing industry also do better, you know, in those kind of countries? And the existing kind of limitations and exceptions surveys don't really get at the key questions, which is when did the law change? You know, so the study yesterday, which has a lot of deep information on exactly these topics, how open is your quotation system? How open is your educational exception? Don't tell us when did you open your quotation exception? When did you adopt a fair use clause, etc.? And so we're trying to put together some information on that point. And the purpose is to, you know, enable more studies like this, of the kind I referred to in the beginning. And so, you know, most of the research in this area on the impact of copyright in the world is dominated by these copyright cultural industry studies. Right? So, you know, this organization produces some of those. And they count heads. They say, you know, here's how big, you know, $1 trillion global economy is implicated by copyright in some way. And those numbers are true, but they're just head counting. They don't actually show the impact of copyright. And you can see the same numbers on the other sides. You know, how big is the exceptions industry? How big is technology and software and computer hardware and the rest of it? But when you actually go into the countries and you look like, what impact did adopting a more open limitation and exception have in the particular country, then what you find is that both the entertainment and content-heavy sectors and the technology environment both grow much faster than countries that don't have it, much faster than they did before the change. And across countries, it appears to hold up as well. And that's just measuring right now the countries that literally adopted fair use, which is fair use as I've defined it, which an open, flexible, and general exception all in a single clause. There's 9 or so of those countries, Singapore, Taiwan, Korea, Malaysia, etc. And when you look at those particular countries, they do better. What I hope to, you know, be able to report back in a year's or so time is how does that openness and flexibility apply within all the different systems as well? You know, so do systems that have openness, flexibility, and generality within their quotation right also have more growth, for instance, in their publications industry, etc.? And if there would be a leave behind on what WIPO could do better in the studies on the L&E studies, and including the education study I mentioned yesterday, and I'll mention this to Professor Singh as well, is to track that data over time, you know, to include one more column within all of these limitation studies and say, when was it adopted? You know, here's what it says now is helpful. When was it adopted will really enable a lot more of this empirical research. And with that, I'll stop. Thank you.
Thank you very much, and yes, indeed. Let's give a round of applause to all of our panelists. Now, we're not going to keep you here too long because you have to get back to the afternoon session. So I'd just like to thank everyone for attending. Because we don't have time for questions now, I'm going to try and set up an Ask Me Anything session with the panelists. I haven't told them this, so this is a surprise to them. online, that maybe we can have questions later. So EFF will be blogging about this session, and you can check out a link on our blog for that Ask Me Anything that we'll do online.
Happy to take emails as well.
Yes, emails as well. If you would like the contact details of any of our panelists, you can track me down and I'll give you their details. I also have business cards if you want to stay in touch. So with that, I thank you again for attending and wish you a productive remainder of SCCR 31, 32. Thank you.